to talk about entanglement, entropy, and causal set theory, and this is based on work with Raphael Sorkin. So we've been studying entanglement, entropy, and causal sets for a while now, and for a long time we were puzzled by the main result which we were getting, which was that the entropy obeyed a spacetime volume law instead of the spatial area law which we expected to get, and which we did get in the continuum situation when we applied the same methods that we were using in the causal set. We're working with a space-time definition of entropy, which is equally meaningful in continuum and causal set space-times. But like I said, they seem to give different results. So what I want to do here is I want to tell you about the space-time definition of entropy which we work with, and then I'll briefly show you the continuum and causal set results. And finally, I'll tell you about what we think is going on and how we can recover the area law in the causal set case. So before I go on, let me very briefly say what a causal set is for those of you who are not familiar with it. So causal set theory is an approach to quantum gravity where the deep structure of space-time is discrete. Formally, the causal set is a locally finite, partially ordered set. The set is the set of space-time elements, and the ordering relation is the causal relations among those elements. And together, they satisfy a set of rules, which I won't go into right now. This is what a typical causal set looks like, whose continuum counterpart would be a causal diamond or interval in 1+1-dimensional Minkowski spacetime. Now, an important feature of this discretization is that, unlike a regular lattice, it's Lorentz invariant. So if I boost this diamond, the distribution of points will look more or less the same because they're randomly distributed. And I'll be mostly talking about results for a massless scalar field in causal diamonds. So the causal sets that I'll be talking about look more or less like this one. Now let me quickly review what the traditional definition of entanglement entropy is. So the usual story is that the entropy is identified with this expression involving a density matrix rho, evaluated on a hypersurface sigma. Now if we take sigma and we divide it into two complementary regions, like region A and B in my figure, and if we trace out the degrees of freedom in one of these regions, for example region B, we end up with a reduced density matrix for region A, and if we plug it back into here, we get an entropy which is referred to as the entanglement entropy between region A and region B, if the original density matrix was pure. Now this definition doesn't work for a causal set because we don't have the notion of data on a hypersurface. But even if it did work, this is not a good definition of entropy, entanglement entropy, because it's not covariant. Essential to getting a finite answer in any entanglement entropy calculation is a UV cutoff. And when the entanglement entropy is defined in this way, we're putting our UV cutoff on the hypersurface. So it's a spatial quantity, it's not covariant. And since we would like fundamental quantities in quantum gravity to be covariant, and we think entanglement entropy is one of these fundamental quantities, we should try and have a covariant definition of it. And this is not one. Now there is a covariant space-time definition of entanglement entropy by Raphael. It's applicable to any globally hyperbolic space-time or causal set, and it's so far been developed for calculations with Gaussian states of scalar fields. For details and a proof of it, I'll refer you to this paper. I'll just state the definition next. So the idea is to try and express the entropy directly in terms of the space-time correlation function. Let me introduce W and delta. W is the Weidman function, so it's just the two-point function of the field. And delta is the Pauli-Jordan function, which is the commutator of the field. Once we have these, the entropy is defined as this sum over the eigenvalues lambda to this generalized eigenvalue problem involving W and delta. And it's important that we not include functions in the kernel of delta. So if if W and delta are restricted to a subregion within a larger space-time, the entropy that you would get out of this formula would be an entanglement entropy. And furthermore, we can compare the results that we get with this definition to those with the other definition if the regions of space-time which we're considering are the domains of dependence of the hypersurfaces in the other definition. So we considered this space-time entropy in continuum space-times with this setup. We have a smaller causal diamond within a larger causal diamond, and we're restricting the field to the smaller diamond with diameter curly L. We understand what W and delta look like in the space-time. We understand all their properties. This is what they look like. U and V are light cone coordinates. We express W and delta as matrices in the eigenbasis of delta, which consists of two sets of eigenfunctions over here. They're basically linear combinations of plane waves. This one has an extra cosine term. And the wave number k is given by n pi over L, where, again, curly L was the diameter of the smaller causal diamond. And these matrices are finite matrices. So we're stopping at some mode when we're making up these matrices. And with the modes that we've retained, we can expand initial data up to wavelengths of 1 over the maximum wave number that we kept, which the maximum wave number would correspond to the last mode in the eigenbasis that we kept. And so it's natural to identify our cutoff with this last largest wave number or smallest wave number that we keep. And in our calculations, we keep the ratio of the sizes of the diamonds fixed, and we just change the sizes of these matrices, in other words, where our largest wave number is. So this is the final result for the entropy, and you can see that it fits almost perfectly the expected result of logarithmic scaling with the cutoff with a 1/3 coefficient. So this is the 1 plus 1 version of the area law. So things seem to be working as expected with this space-time formula in the continuum. Now we can do the exact same thing for the causal set. Again, we have the setup of a smaller causal diamond within a larger causal diamond. Again, we understand what W and delta look like for these causal sets. Delta can also be expressed as the difference between the retarded Green's function and its transpose. And the retarded Green's function is 1/2 the causal matrix, where the causal matrix is a matrix where we put a 1 whenever two spacetime elements are causally related, and we put a 0 otherwise. And we also put zeros on the diagonal. For W, we use something called the Sorkin-Johnston-Whiteman function. I don't have time to tell you about the Sorkin-Johnston prescription, but I'll just say that it's a prescription for setting up a quantum field theory that works for both causal sets and continuum spacetimes, and it basically gives you a reasonable choice for a vacuum state. And I'll also add that the W that you get with this SJ prescription in the causal set agrees well with the W that I showed you from the continuum a few slides ago. And that's what this plot shows. So this plot shows the real part of the Whiteman function, or W, for the continuum diamond and the causal set diamond as a function of proper distance. So the solid black line is the continuum Whiteman function real part, and the blue dots are the causal set values. So they agree fairly well with each other. Now, in this case, again, we're keeping the ratio of the sizes of the diamonds fixed, and we are varying the density of the points that we put into these diamonds. And that's how we're changing our cutoff. Our cutoff goes as will be proportional to the square root of the number of elements in these diamonds if we're holding the sizes fixed. So here's the result that we get for the entropy in the causal set case. The entropy scales linearly with the number of elements in the smaller diamond, for example. So I told you that the cutoff scales with square root n, so we were expecting a logarithmic scaling with square root n, which would also mean a logarithmic scaling with n itself, but we're getting a linear scaling with n. And not only is the scaling different from what we expected, but the magnitudes of the entropies are also much larger than they were in the continuum case. And this is the result that had been puzzling us for a long time. We tried changing many things in the setup to try and understand this result. For example, we looked at the massive case, in case this is an artifact of the massless theory. We looked at 3+1 dimensions. We looked at regular lattices, non-local two-point functions, all kinds of things. But this result of linear scaling with the number of elements kept persisting. So this is a spacetime volume law, because the volume grows with n, and the entropy is growing linearly with n. And the difference between the left and right figures are just different ratios of the sizes of the two diamonds. So on the left, the ratios were 1/4, and on the right, the ratio is 1/2. Finally, we realized the source of this result, and the source ended up being this kernel condition on delta. Now, I told you that it's important that we throw out functions in the kernel of delta. But while this is easy to do in the continuum, it's not so easy to do for the causal set. If you actually look at the spectrum of delta in the causal set, you'll see that the kernel is actually much smaller than it was in the continuum. But what you'll instead see is a whole bunch of small but finite eigenvalues in the causal set case, which weren't there in the continuum. So looking at these small but finite eigenvalues, there was the worry that, well, maybe these small eigenvalues really shouldn't be there. And maybe they are functions like the ones in the kernel, but because of errors introduced by discreteness, they're coming out as finite. So we went ahead and we started removing some of these small eigenvalues and looking at the entropy again. And sure enough, the scaling started becoming logarithmic with the UV cutoff instead of linear. Until if the smallest eigenvalue that you keep is of the magnitude of square root n, where n is the number of elements in the smaller diamond, if that's the magnitude of the smallest eigenvalue, then not only do you get the correct logarithmic scaling with the UV cutoff, but you even get the right coefficient of 1/3. And in hindsight, it makes sense that this had to be the value of the smallest eigenvalue in the causal set, because we can compare the spectrum of delta in the causal set and the continuum. And if we compare what this value corresponds to in the continuum, it corresponds to the shortest wavelength in the continuum case. So this is where the cutoff should be. So any eigenvalue with a value smaller than this corresponds indeed to junk solutions that are beyond our cutoff, and we need to throw these out. And indeed, if we carry this out, for any ratio of sizes of diamonds, we get the correct scaling and the correct coefficient. I'll conclude by saying that, so we have the space-time entropy definition, which works in the continuum and causal set space-times. But for a long time, we were puzzled by the result which we were getting by a naive direct application of this space-time formula to the causal set. But we've realized that we can recover the area law in the causal set case if we change this kernel condition to have our smallest eigenvalue have a magnitude of square root n, where n is the number of elements in the smaller diamond. And we understand this as corresponding to the cutoff and the need for an extra imposing of the cutoff. And this is important for causal sets because we're beginning to understand entanglement entropy in causal sets, and we can begin to think about things like black hole entropy, which is conjectured to be mostly or all entanglement entropy. And it can also be important for continuum calculations if we view this formalism as a tool to do calculations in the continuum. Because these kinds of entanglement entropy calculations in CFDs are actually very difficult to do. And with this definition, they're actually, and in the causal set, they're very easy to do. It's very easy matrix algebra. So it could potentially be a powerful tool for people who are more interested in the continuum. Thank you. Thank you.